Hello and welcome back to the second week of our class on autonomous navigation for flying robots. My name is Daniel Kremers and I will start off this week's class where we learn about 2D and 3D geometry that we need to model the sensors of our quadrotor. Before we get into modeling the geometry, I will give you a brief recap of linear algebra so that we're all on the same page and speak the same language. Most of this should already be familiar to you. If it is not, then I strongly recommend that you first attend a class on linear algebra before continuing here. The entities that we'll be working with in this class are scalars, vectors, and matrices. Scalars are just real numbers that we denote by lowercase letters typeset in italics. Vectors are sets of numbers, say in Rn, that we denote by lowercase letters typeset in bold. And matrices are arrays of m by n numbers that we denote in uppercase letters typeset in bold. When we talk about vectors, we typically mean column vectors, which just means that you stack the n numbers. There are many ways you can see and interpret vectors. The most intuitive way is to think of a vector as a point in an n-dimensional space. So, for example, a 3D vector simply denotes a point in 3D where the three components are its coordinates. Once we have vectors, we can define different operations on these vectors. We can define scalar multiplication, which simply means you multiply the vector x by a scalar s, and what you obtain is another vector that has the same direction as x, but it is rescaled by the number little s. With two vectors, x and y, we can define addition and subtraction of vectors. Furthermore, for a vector x, we can define the length of that vector, or the norm. There is actually different ways to measure lengths. The one that we use in this class is the most common one, and that is the so-called L2 norm or Euclidean norm of that vector. And it simply corresponds to the square root of the sum of squared components. Furthermore, we can define normalized vectors, which is here for a vector x, for example, the normalized version x hat is obtained by dividing that vector by its length. What we obtain then is a unit vector, so a vector of length 1 that has the same direction as x. For two vectors, we can define a dot product or scalar product denoted by this little black dot here. It's a scalar number associated with these two vectors, which is actually maximal if the two vectors are in parallel and then just corresponds to the product of their lengths. And in general, it denotes the projection of the vector x onto the vector y, or vice versa. And in the case that the two vectors are orthogonal, the dot product is zero. Furthermore, we can define for vectors in R3 a so-called cross product. That is another vector assigned to the two vectors x and y, which is orthogonal to the plane spanned by x and y. And you can remember which direction it's pointing by the so-called right-hand rule. And that rule says that if the first vector x points in direction of your thumb, and the second point in direction of your index finger, then the cross product is a vector pointing in direction of the middle finger. Here is a more formal definition of the cross product, which allows you to actually compute the cross product for two vectors x and y. It's given by this expression on the right-hand side, which contains the various components xi and yi of the two vectors x and y. In addition, there is a matrix notation for the cross product where we introduce this skew or anti-symmetric matrix that contains the three elements of x. And then we can reproduce the cross product of x and y by just multiplying the vector y with this matrix. This turns out to be useful because it allows you to replace the cross product by a simple matrix vector product. For matrices, we will use the following convention. An n by m matrix is an array of numbers where n denotes the number of rows and m the number of columns. It has a lot of components, xij, where the first index I refers to the row and the second index refers to the column. For matrices, there's actually different types of matrices that we can distinguish. Square matrices are matrices where the number of rows and columns is equal, in contrast to the more general case of rectangular matrices. Then we have diagonal matrices. These are matrices where only the diagonal elements are non-zero. In addition, we have upper and lower diagonal matrices, which are matrices where the non-zero elements are all above or below the diagonal. Furthermore, we have symmetric matrices. These are matrices where the transpose is equal to the matrix itself. The transpose is obtained by mirroring along the diagonal, and so that leaves the matrix unchanged for symmetric matrices. In contrast to so-called skew-symmetric or anti-symmetric matrices, where transposing the matrix gives you the negative of that matrix. Then we have positive definite or positive semi-definite matrices. A positive definite matrix is a matrix X such that for any vector A, the quadratic form A transpose XA is always positive. And positive semi-definite if it is always non-negative. We have orthogonal matrices. These are matrices where the transpose is equal to the inverse. We will see later in class that orthogonal matrices include rotation matrices, but they can also be, for example, mirroring. There are many operations we can define on matrices. For example, we can simply define a matrix vector multiplication where we multiply the vector X by the matrix M. Furthermore, we can define matrix-matrix multiplications, M1 times M2, provided, of course, that the dimensions of the matrices are consistent. We'll see, for example, that this allows to model concatenations of rotations. Then we can define the inverse of a matrix, M to the minus 1. That assumes, first of all, that the matrix is a rectangle, is a square matrix, and secondly, that the matrix is actually invertible. Invertible matrices can be identified by having a non-zero determinant and by having a full rank equivalent. The transpose of a matrix, as I mentioned, is obtained by simply mirroring along the diagonal. Furthermore, there exist various decompositions of matrices. In this class, we will be using in particular the singular value decomposition and the eigendecomposition. The singular value decomposition holds for any rectangular matrix. It tells you that the matrix M can be decomposed into a product of matrices U, sigma, V star, where U and V denote orthogonal transformations, and sigma is a diagonal matrix containing the singular value. For square matrices, we can define an eigendecomposition where again M is decomposed as Q lambda Q inverse, Q being an orthogonal matrix, and lambda being a diagonal matrix that contains the eigenvalues, little lambda. There is the eigenvalue equation, which essentially tells us that a vector V is an eigenvector to an eigenvalue lambda if multiplying the vector V with the matrix A, does nothing but rescale that vector with lambda. In particular, these decompositions, the singular and eigenvalue decomposition, tell us a little bit about how a matrix acts on vectors. What have we learned in this class? We've learned a little bit, a recap on linear algebra. We learned the notation that we will be using in this course. We learned about scalars, vectors, and matrices, and some of the most important operations on these. As I mentioned, if this was not familiar to you, please do go and revisit a class on linear algebra to get back on track. In the next class, we will then see how these notations and terms can be used to model 2D and 3D geometry that we need to model the sensors of our quadrotor.